Thanks.
Isn't that just a good reminder that once his enemy, but now seated at his table, Jesus, thank you. That's what we're here for today, to give thanks to the Lord our God for his great salvation and to spend ourselves for his glory. Good morning. Welcome. I'm Pastor Francis. It's my pleasure to serve this church and many of you for a good number of years. It's a joy. A couple of notes just as you're thinking about your bulletin and church life. There is a message from our dear treasurer just saying, please go check your mailboxes. Not right now, but after the service, you'll find your tax papers there. So please go look at, in your mailbox. If you don't think you have a mailbox, you're probably wrong. You probably do. Go check anyway. It should be by your last name, and go see what kind of goodies are in there. There's, you never know, Rebecca, there might be something sweet in there. Wednesdays, our regular Wednesday studies have begun. This means that there is something for everybody Wednesday. There are several women's studies during the day. There's a whole family study at night. If you don't have a Bible study on Wednesday, if you're looking for something, come on out at 6 o'clock. There are classes for the kids as well. And so 6 o'clock is pizza. 6:30, the studies begin. The younger ones end by 7:30, so you can get the kids to bed if you need to. The older ones sometimes go a little longer. There's two requests for help in your bulletin. Find those. That's your homework, at least the first part of your homework. And there's also a new membership class coming up in, I think it's the first weekend in February. Take a look there if you're interested to know more about New Hope or if you're ready to become a member. So I think that was the gist of it. There's one more thing here. I don't know where it is. There we go. You guys familiar with these things? You probably kind of notice them every week. I want more of you to use them. This is what for. I'd love for you to, if you have something specific you'd like prayer for, please write it on there and put it in the offering plate. That way I get it. If you want it to the whole elder board, just write that down. Share with elders. Otherwise, I'll pray myself for however you want. If you're visiting this morning, we're really glad you're here. This is also for you. If you're visiting, I'd love to get to know you a little bit, introduce you to more of the church. So same thing. Just fill this out and we'll be in touch. And I just welcome you further into our church family. So, now, would you please open your bulletin there on page 3? I want to read one of the reflections this morning, because this morning we're going to be meditating on the grandeur of God and our fear. Those two things kind of running together. And the second quote there, they're both really, I think, thought-provoking, but John Piper writes this. You can read along with me at the second paragraph on page 3. When we feel like everything is uncertain, when the mountains might as well crash into the sea, the first thing we do is remember that our protection is not in better circumstances or in avoiding the problems or in anything on earth. Instead, our protection is the very present Holy Spirit and the rock-solid work of Jesus on our behalf, which has guaranteed our help and promised that we will make it safely home to glory. That's my prayer this morning, that the Holy Spirit would lift our eyes up to behold by faith the grandeur of God and the beauty of Jesus, and that the Holy Spirit would get a hold of you so that you would look more to him than to your circumstances. And that when you are afraid, there's lots of reasons to be afraid, but that when you're giving way to fear, you readjust your gaze and you remember your ever-present help. Let me just pray really briefly to that end, and then I'll have you stand and we'll hear God call us to worship him. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, would you do what we just talked about? Would you open our eyes, our minds, to see the magnificence of who you are, so that when things aren't going like we want, when we're looking down the road of the future and we're afraid, we're worried, that you would meet us, and that who you are would be our reality more than the things here on earth. That we would face the things on earth with faith, fixed on your goodness and your power, your holiness and your presence. Would you meet with us now? Would you catch us up to actually be worshiping you this morning? That we would be marveling in real time at who you are. Hear us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you please stand together and open your bulletins to page 3 at the bottom, where we have a call to worship, where God calls you, his people, to give him glory, to worship him. The The note there is that theme of his presence, the Lord on our side, and then verse 8, our help is where? Not my own machinations, not my own abilities or wisdom. No, our help is in the Lord, the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. So when we read that, I want you to particularly say with strength, verse 8. God calls you to worship. If it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side when people rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us up alive when their anger was kindled against us. Then the flood would have swept us away. The torrent would have gone over us. Then over us would have gone the raging waters. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. We've escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken, and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Fix your gaze on our unchanging God, on the grandeur of your God. We're going to do that in these two songs. Look with me just a moment on page 4. The first phrase we're going to sing, eternal God, unchanging, mysterious and unknown, your boundless love unfailing, in grace and mercy shown. And then skip down to verse 2, Lord, we are weak and frail, helpless in the storm. Where are you looking? And then the second song, surrounded by our fears, what do? Give way? Freak out? We look to heaven. We look to heaven. Look at the refrain. We look to Christ till your glory fills our eyes and our faith is turned to sight, till our thirsty souls are satisfied. How long? Would you look in faith to our great King? Let's sing together.
Every than all the moons and all the stars in all the universe. Sing praises to the living God who rules them by his word. Hallelujah. How long, O Lord, how long?
join me in prayer? Who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and marked off the heavens with a span? Only you, the eternal God, unchanging, unflinching, untiring, boundless in love, steadfast love, consistent, abundant, unfailing in grace and mercy. And this morning, we are weak. We're helpless, more helpless than we usually tell people. We're frail. We're fearful. But our faith is in you, and rightly so, because we know your goodness in you, Lord Jesus. And so we lean on your promises that you will be with us, that you will keep us, that you will protect us, that you'll bring us home. Be our sovereign God and cause us to flee to you, cause us to look to you, cause us to be satisfied in you. Make us taste a little more of that this morning, that we might be satisfied, that we might go our way rejoicing, having met with you, the living God, the maker of heaven and earth. In Christ we ask this. Amen. I'd like to invite you to be seated and turn to page 5 as we look at our confession of sin, followed by our assurance of pardon. This is a rendition of the Ten Commandments. You'll see those in the parts that I read, but with a response from the New Testament's teaching from the Word. Let's read that responsively. Hear, O people of God, the law which the Lord speaks in your hearing this day, that you may know his statutes and walk according to his ordinances. Teach us, O Lord, the grace of your law, and give us life by your word. The God who saved us in Jesus Christ gave this law, saying, I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me. We will worship the Lord our God and serve only him. You shall not make yourself an image of anything to worship it. Living no more in bondage to earthly gods, we will worship the Lord our God in spirit and in truth. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord. We will use the holy name of God with reverence, praising him in everything we do and say. You shall observe the Sabbath by keeping it holy, for in six days you shall labor and do all your work. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The first part of the law is this great commandment, that we love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our mind, and with all our strength. The second part of the law is similar to the first. You shall honor your father and mother, that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. As children, we will be obedient to our parents in the Lord. As parents, we will correct our children and guide them in the training and instruction of the Lord. We will respect the lawful authorities appointed by God. You shall not murder. We will be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave us. You shall not commit adultery. We will use our bodies in ways that are holy and honorable, and abstain from immorality and impurity. You shall not steal. We will do what we can for our neighbor's good, and work faithfully so that we may share with the poor. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. We will speak the truth with our neighbor in love, render judgments that are true and make for peace, and not devise in our hearts any evil against anyone. You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. We will be content, whatever the circumstances, through the strength of Christ within us. Thus we must love our neighbors as ourselves. For the Lord requires us to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God. Amen. I'd like to invite you to a prayer of confession. As we just read the law, it was a provocation unto obedience. This is the way. This is how to love God. This is how to love your neighbor. walk in it. Would you ask God to strengthen you in your walk with Him in a few moments of silent prayer? Holy Spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ, would you strengthen us to fight sin with great vigor and strengthen us to fight even harder for righteousness, to honor you, to display our love for you in joyful obedience. We've come confessing that we've not done this as we ought, but we come in the name of Jesus, our Redeemer, the Goel, the great Ransomer. Forgive us and strengthen us that we might walk righteously in Jesus. We pray in His name, amen. Would you hear from God's word, His words of assurance? Psalm 79 and then Romans 8, 1. Do not remember against us our former iniquities. Let your compassion come speedily to meet us, for we are brought very low. Help us, O God of our salvation, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and atone for our sins for your name's sake. In Romans 8, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Receive God's assurance that if you put your trust in Him, and as you do, your sins are forgiven, your iniquities are taken away. God declares you righteous and cleansed, His beloved. Rejoice in that truth. We're going to respond in song with I Have a Shelter. Just before you stand, we'll also be taking the offering during that time. Give to the Lord out of your thanksgiving for the work of His gospel ministry to go forward. If you're visiting this morning, please feel no obligation to give. This is the church family's business, as it were, to keep the ministry going. So give to the Lord, give Him faith, and give joyfully. Now let's stand together and sing while the offering is being taken. I Have a Shelter in the Storm. It's on page 6 and 7. Let's stand.
I have a shelter.
I've been made free. Oh, Comforter, in me reside. When the tempter speaks, be my faithful guide. Show your promises for me secured, for the battle be my heavenly sword. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
God's people said, amen. I'd like to invite you to be seated, and I'd like to just move the congregational prayer to after the sermon. I think as you hear the sermon, you'll understand it just flows kind of better after the sermon than before. So at this point, I'd like to invite the children to head off to Children's Church. If that's where your parents would like you to go, you're welcome to be dismissed at this point. And for those children, youth, and perhaps adults staying, you want to do a little drawing while you listen. Sometimes it helps you listen better. If you can draw a worm, but this worm needs a transformation. It needs to be transformed into, I'll say a threshing sledge, but you might want to say a plow. So somehow you got to make this worm become a plow, because God can transform all things. He can take very small things and use them powerfully in his strength. And then the word to listen for this morning is going to be the word fear. It comes up three times in our text. It's kind of the theme of Isaiah 41. As God comforts his people, he speaks into their fears and reminds them to put it in the context of who he is. So that's, if you'd like to use your children's bulletins for that end, if you would turn over to Isaiah chapter 41, we'll read the first 20 verses. That will be our text for today. I'm planning to take it in chunks. I was hoping I don't forget to read any of it. So let's look at Isaiah 41. We'll read verses 1 through 7 to begin with. Isaiah 41, it's in your bulletin on the bottom of page 7. This is God's word. Listen to me in silence, O coastlands. Let the peoples renew their strength. Let them approach, then let them speak. Let us together draw near for judgment. Who stirred up one from the east whom victory meets at every step? He gives up nations before him so that he tramples kings underfoot. He makes them like dust with his sword, like driven stubble with his bow. He pursues them and passes on safely by paths his feet have not trod. Who has performed and done this, calling the generations from the beginning? I, the Lord, the first and with the last, I am he. The coastlands have seen and are afraid. The ends of the earth tremble. They have drawn near and come. Everyone helps his brother and says to his Everyone helps his neighbor and says to his brother, be strong. The craftsman strengthens the goldsmith, and he who smooths with the hammer, him who strikes the anvil, saying of the soldering, it is good. And they strengthen it with nails so that it cannot be moved. We'll continue on through the various points with the rest of the text. One of these days, we're going to have a confession of sin for false prophets. Because if you think about what a false prophet is, we're all guilty of being false prophets. A false prophet is somebody who looks into the future and says, that's going to happen. And we do that all the time, don't we? It's actually one of the fruit of fear. When we're afraid, we're casting the future and saying, this is how it's going to go, I know. We do it with something as simple as the weather. It's going to be a horrible, horrible weather on my birthday. I just know it. We can do it with more significant things. If I say that, I'm going to have a horrible response. This relationship's going to end up this way. I'm hopeless because things are not going to turn around. There's all kinds of ways we can look into the future and say, it's going to go, usually it's terribly. We don't usually predict good news, do we? And in that sense, we're being false prophets. We're giving way to fear. We're saying, this is the way. And we live in light of it. And so often our anxieties and fears are really for no reason. There's no basis. Fear is a result of false prophecy. Now imagine if you don't believe in God, how much greater the fear is. How much more there is to be afraid of. There's no one in control. There is no plan. Your suffering has no purpose. There is no ultimate truth, and so nothing ultimately matters. You are on your own. There's much to be afraid of. But Isaiah, here in our text, says three different times, we'll come to them in time, he says, fear not, fear not, fear not. And he begins by speaking to those who don't know the Lord, the coastlands, the peoples. He invites them, look at verse 1 there, to come and make a judgment on who he is so that they can renew their strength. Oh, that sounds a lot like last week where he was speaking to the believers. Look at chapter 40, verse 30. You see that parallel there, right? They who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. Now the Lord is, it's like he's inviting the nations, those who don't know the Lord yet, I want you to know that same strength so that you don't give way to fear. Come and behold the God of all the earth. This whole section, if we just step back a moment, is still expanding on God's comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. Chapter 40, verse 1. And remember, the main comfort that God promises is that the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all flesh will see it together. Jesus will come, and people will see, the whole earth will see the splendor of God as is portrayed in Jesus. That was chapter 40, verse 5. And now God is extending that comfort to the nations, and he'll come back to the faithful in verse 8. And he does it by revealing his glory a little further. I want to look at that together. I want to see how the grandeur of God reduces our fears. The theme of the sermon, I think of the text here, is fear not, for God Almighty is your helper. And so let's look at his invitation to not fear. He begins in verse 2 with a very similar pattern to last week with all these questions. He says, who stirred up one from the east whom victory meets at every step? He doesn't name Cyrus here, but a couple chapters down we're going to read that this is Cyrus. Cyrus, within the span of 10 years, conquers almost the whole known world. All the Iranian plateau, all of Babylon, Asia Minor, Syria, Palestine. It's like victory at every step. He should have been playing poker, but it's just success after success after success. The nations fall before him. He tramples kings underfoot. He strikes them like dust with the sword. He pursues them. He's never even been in that region before, and he still defeats them all. You can imagine the fear as you're sitting there in Israel, and here comes Cyrus. But God says, don't fear, because who's the one in control of all of this? Who's the one who, as it were, pulls the strings for Cyrus to do what he does? That's his question, right? Verse 2, who stirred him up? Who, verse 4, has performed this and done this? Who's sovereign over all of history? Who gives victory that nations rise and fall? This is the question God's putting before the coastlands. Where does authority and rule and success come from? And he broadens the question in verse 4. Not simply who's performed this of that raging successful king, but he calls the generations from the beginning. The point there is that God from the very beginning has been doing this, not just this one time in history, but through all of history. God himself is the one who rules over all. You see his answer there, don't you, in verse 4? Who does this? Who's ultimately in charge of all things? I, the Lord, the first, and with the last, I am he. The beginning and the end, you see right there. His plan's been from the beginning, and he keeps it. He knows the end from the beginning. This God doesn't change. He doesn't blink. He doesn't fall asleep. He controls all in heaven and earth, all empires, all kings, all kingdoms. They all do his bidding. Now just imagine for a minute that you're afraid of what's going to come. And then the Spirit reminds you of this text. I'm the sovereign over all history. Always have been. Always will be. And you take that in and drink it down. And what happens? Peace. You don't have to be in control of your future. You don't have to give way to fear about what's going to happen in this country or any other country that you love and know. Peace. Because you trust this sovereign one. You trust God's ultimate plan and purpose. You trust his control and power. You trust his wisdom. If this God is your God, then you need not fear. Cyrus is in his hand, and your future is too. God would remind you this morning not to give way to fear, because the God, the living God, is in charge of all, and he's good. One fellow put it this way. He said, this truth about God is a pillow fit for the most aching head, a sedative for the most tattered nerves, and a ground for trusting the divine promises. God holds it out to you and to the coastlands. But the coastlands see it. Verse 5. They're afraid just like everybody else. But instead of turning to the Lord, they turn to their own hammered idols, their own hammered gods, and try to find refuge there. In contrast, you look at verse 8. This is how the nations respond to the glory of the power of God, sovereign over all. The nations give way to fear and turn away from God. the faithful turn to God. But you, Israel, my servant, is a contrast. Let's look at that together. It's my second point. God upholds you. Look at verse 8. We'll read verse 8 to 13. But you, Israel, my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the offspring of Abraham, my friend, you whom I took from the ends of the earth and called from its farthest corners, saying to you, you are my servant. I have chosen you and not cast you off. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Behold, all who are incensed against you shall be put to shame and confounded. Those who strive against you shall be as nothing and shall perish. You shall seek those who contend with you, but you shall not find them. Those who war against you shall be as nothing at all. For I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. It is I who say to you, fear not. I am the one who helps you. God's people don't respond the same way as the coastlands or those who don't love the Lord. No, they face the same fears. They fear the same powers, the same shakings of the heart. But they don't give way because God upholds them. You see that little phrase in verse 10, I will uphold you. God reminds his people of their security. You're not cut adrift. You're not by yourself or alone. I uphold you. Look there with me at verse 8. You see several things in sequence. First, he emphasizes the fact that they're chosen. You, Israel, that's God's chosen people. My servant Jacob, who was a wrestler with God, and yet God was with him, giving him a limp. God preserved him. I have chosen you. That idea of choosing comes up again in verse 9. You're my servant. I've chosen you and not cast you off. You see here the doctrine of election, that before the foundations of the earth, Ephesians 1:4, God chose his people for himself. And what Isaiah is doing here is he's giving strength to his people. If God chose you from, you remember, how does it say, from the ends of the earth I called you, from the farthest corners. Abraham was a wandering Aramean. Nobody knew him. He was in the furthest, nobody knows where, place of all the earth. But God knew him. God called him. God chose him. You are mine, Abraham. And you see what Isaiah is reminding his people here is that God from before the world began has chosen you, and he's not going to unchoose you. He's elected you and will keep you. You see the strength there of this doctrine of election. If God calls, if God chooses, can you get away from that? No, God will keep you. This is a doctrine that way back in the 1500s was very dear to the folks' hearts. Actually reading a book on history the other day and just looking at the time around the Reformation, this doctrine came to the fore. And I just read a little bit just to underline what Isaiah's or God's trying to do in us. The Christian's assurance of his election to eternal life was the deepest source of his confidence, his fearlessness, his humility, and his moral power. If God be for us, who shall be against us? I think that's how we're meant to use this text. If God has called you and chosen you, what if I'm not elect? Well, ask the question, do you love the Lord? Are you running to him for salvation? That's the question you need to answer, that question. But then use that doctrine of God's choosing his election as a strength, a confidence, a fearlessness, because God will not let you go. Who's against you then if God is on your side? The security of God's people in his choosing. But they're also secure because they're justified. Look at the end of verse 8. The offspring of Abraham, my friend. Abraham, close relationship with God, called his friend. How are they his offspring? Because Abraham was made a promise. And all his descendants would be children of Abraham, offspring of Abraham, if by faith they believed the promise of God, of salvation in Jesus. You can read about that in Galatians. So he's reminding them that they're true offspring of Abraham if by faith they're believing the God of Abraham and the promises of Abraham that I will be your God through the Lord Jesus Christ, justified by faith. Look at Romans 4 as well. The security that they're friends with God because of that washing blood of Jesus, the forgiveness of sins in him. Then he reminds them that they are, verse 9 then, you are my servant. God's not putting his people in their places, where he's reminding them that he's their God, they're his servant. There's a committed relationship of care there by God to his people. So the security of God's people in election, the security of God, of God's people in their justification, the security of God in his commitment to care. Is it any wonder then that God says in verse 10, fear not. You're absolutely secure in me. Don't give way to fear. Because I am with you. If you translate it literally, it's Emmanuel. Fear not, Emmanuel. You have questions if God is with you? Well, look to the Lord Jesus. I am with you. Emmanuel, God with us. Be not dismayed. Don't be thrown off by all the future, for I am your God. There's that covenant. I'll be God to you. You'll be my people. I will strengthen you. I will help you. This isn't me saying. This isn't your mother or your grandfather saying this. This is the living God of all the earth saying, I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you. Think of a mother with a little one in the pool, upholding that little one. But God upholds us with his righteous right hand, that delivering arm of power. There's no reason to fear, because God Almighty is your helper. Isn't that so? God, help us to live like it. But as God delivers his people and he upholds them, he not only saves his people, but he confounds their enemies. Verse 11, all those incensed against God's people shall be put to shame and confounded. God's deliverance of his people means the defeat of his and their enemies. All your enemies will perish. That's that next phrase. It's actually the heart of this section, that those who have been raising themselves, the enemies of God's people, will be found no more. So don't be afraid, says God. There's not a specific enemy mentioned here. You might wish for that. You might wish that today God would say, okay, this is your enemy, I'm going to take him out. But he doesn't. He leaves it vague because of this. And here's another quote. In the coming to realization of God's kingdom, the kingdom of evil will be subdued. That's the main point. As God causes his kingdom in Jesus to come, the kingdom of evil will be subdued. Think about our main enemies, sin in the world, sin in ourselves, and the devil himself. God will destroy all of those. Ultimately, when he comes back in Jesus, but already now. Think about it for just a minute. Does the devil have any condemning power anymore in the Lord Jesus? Or has Jesus thrashed him? So he might whimper a little bit yet, a little bit of power yet, but his condemning power is gone, isn't it? Look over in Zechariah for a minute. It's like the fifth last book or so of the Old Testament. Maybe it's the fourth, I'm not sure. There's a vivid picture there of this very fact pointing so clearly to the Lord Jesus. Zechariah chapter 3. There's the high priest Joshua standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. So there's Satan, his finger in Joshua's face, accusing him of all of his sins. And then verse 2, the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire? I have chosen. I've taken them back out of judgment. I will keep them. And then he goes on a little bit further. Verse 4, the angel said to those who were standing before him, remove the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments. This is a picture of what Jesus does to sinners. He rebukes Satan. You have no authority to accuse. Oh, what you say is true, Satan, except I've paid for their sins. I put my righteousness on Joshua the high priest. I put my robe of righteousness on all who put their trust in me. I've taken their iniquity away. The devil's been defeated by the Lord Jesus. God upholds you. Don't give way to fear. He will destroy all your enemies. That one we've looked at, the devil, no more condemnation. It's the same with the world. The Lord Jesus has taken the power of the world's influence and crushed it. We're still in the world, but we're no longer of the world. We're citizens of another kingdom. So many places we could look here. Let's just look at John 15. We might look at 2. John 15, verse 19. Oops, I'm in Romans. John 15, 19. How Jesus has destroyed the power of the world. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. You don't belong to the world anymore. The Lord Jesus has taken you out of the sewer, as it were, and put you in his kingdom. It doesn't have that power over you anymore. And that relates, of course, to the power of sin being broken in our lives. You can read Romans chapter 6, the whole chapter, if you will, on your own. But there, we've been raised from death to life. Don't let sin reign in you any longer, because that's not you who you are. You're one who's been raised up. You're not dead in your sin anymore. But look over John 16. John 16 and verse 7. I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. Jesus has conquered the power of our sinful natures by delivering us from its bondage and the slavery to it. But more than that, guys, don't forget this. As a believer, he sent the Holy Spirit to dwell in you so you have the strength to resist. You don't have to give way to sin anymore. And I don't think we lever that as much as we ought to. Where the Spirit dwells within you to lead us into truth, to lead us in step with the Spirit in love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, and self-control. And so Isaiah reminds us here that the day will come when our enemies will be no more. They've been defeated now. The end will come when they're completely vanquished and we're pure and holy. But in the meantime, he says, fear not. Verse 13, I, the Lord your God, hold your right hand. I'm not going to let you go. Fear not. I am the one who helps you. Fear not, dear friends. When sin troubles you, when Satan tempts you, when the world has its aroma about you, because God will help you. He will hold you. But then turn to him in prayer and ask him, hold me fast, keep me, give me strength to resist, pour out more of your Spirit upon me now that I can say no to this and yes to this. Lean on him. Lean in to him. So far we've seen that God is God over all, so don't fear. That God upholds you, his people, so don't give way to fear. The next thing we'll look at is how God strengthens you. God strengthens you, verses 14 to 16. There God writes in his word, fear not, you worm Jacob, you men of Israel. I am the one who helps you, declares the Lord. Your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. Behold, I make of you a threshing sledge, new, sharp, and having teeth. You shall thresh the mountains and crush them. You shall make the hills like chaff. You shall winnow them, and the wind shall carry them away, and the tempest shall scatter them. You shall rejoice in the Lord, in the Holy One of Israel, you shall glory. It's kind of a funny comfort, isn't it? God's comfort is, don't fear because you're a worm. And you're like, huh, that's interesting. What are we to make of that? Well, I think it's maybe helpful to think about all the teams that you know that have a mascot of a worm. Does anybody know any? I just don't think many teams, maybe a little kid's team perhaps, but a football team? Hockey team, they're just not there because, well, worms aren't very inspiring. They're weak, they're humble, they're low to the ground. What can a worm do? I think that's God's point. Remember who you are. You are weak, you're small, you're powerless, perhaps even undeserving. And that's so often why we're afraid, because we're not big enough to do what's in front of us. We're not strong enough to defeat the big guy, whoever that may be. But God's point is, you're not meant to be strong. God is your strength. Your strength is not from you. Your strength is in the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. That's where he goes here, because look, he doesn't just draw the parallel with God's people and worms, but look what he does in verse 15. Behold, I make of you a threshing sledge, new, sharp, having teeth, able to thresh mountains and flatten them. God can take the weak and make them strong. God can use the worms for massive purposes. A threshing sledge, it's a heavy platform with underneath sharp stuff attached to it that they drag over stalks to crush them or to knock off all the little the grains from whether it's corn or wheat, whatever it is, to prepare them for threshing so you get rid of all the little the peels, the husks. How does God do that with such weak people? How is it possible when we're so small and weak and prone to fear and to wander? Well, it's because of what comes in between those two pictures, the worm and the threshing sledge. Look with me in verse 14. It's because I am the one who helps you, declares the Lord. Your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. Redeemer there, that's the word Goel. You know that from the book of Ruth, where Boaz is the kinsman redeemer. That's Goel. The one who ransoms, the family that's the closest that goes out and cares for you and pays off the debt that you couldn't pay. The one who does all for you. God says, I'm that. I'm your nearest of kin to care for you, to strengthen you, to uphold you, to keep you. It's my power that takes the weak and makes them strong, or takes small things and causes them to do my purposes. That's what God is after. To care, provide, protect, and shelter. We're not to look at our own strength or our own weakness, but God's power to act. Isn't that what Ephesians says? Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God. Not your armor, not your wisdom, but God's armor, his salvation, his truth, his word. Doesn't God do that with prayer? What's prayer? It's weak. Just words. Except it's words to the living God. And doesn't James say, Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed that it would not rain. It didn't rain for 3.5 years. Your prayers in the hands of a mighty God do mighty things. Never give up. What about a cup of water? The service of the saints. It's insignificant. Except on the last day, Jesus says, you did that for me. God can use our weakest things in his hands, and they can become powerful things for his glory. Think of the Lord Jesus himself, weak as a worm on the one hand, but the power of God unto salvation on the other. You may be weak, but your God is strong. So appeal to him. Depend on him. Lean on him, particularly in prayer. Spread his word. That's what Paul did with the Thessalonians. When you heard the word that we shared with you, you received it as the very word of God, and you turned from idols to serve the living and true God. The words of but a worm in the hands of a powerful God. And their idols were threshed. And they put their trust in him. So don't fear your weakness. Look to your God. And finally, the last few verses, we'll see that God refreshes the saints. Verse 17 through 20. Here's a picture of pilgrims in the desert. When the poor and needy seek water, this is verse 17 to the end. When the poor and needy seek water and there is none, and their tongue is parched with thirst, I, the Lord, will answer them. I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will open rivers on the bare heights and fountains in the midst of the valleys. I will make the wilderness a pool of water and the dry land springs of water. I will put in the wilderness the cedar, the acacia, the myrtle, and the olive. I will set in the desert the cypress, the plane, and the pine together, that they may see and know, may consider and understand together that the hand of the Lord has done this. The Holy One of Israel has created it. The picture's clear, isn't it? The tongue parched. I don't know if you've ever had that. You've just not had enough water, and it's hot. And your tongue is kind of sticking in your mouth, and you can't really talk properly. That's the picture. And God says, I'm going to answer that. I'm going to meet that need. I'm going to refresh my people. This certainly could be physically, or emotionally, or financially, whatever it may even bring them back to the promised land. But the picture here of God refreshing in the wilderness is usually used for spiritual barrenness, weakness, and bleakness. Turn over to chapter 55 for a minute with me. You'll see that same picture. God brings refreshment by abundant waters on the barren heights, by bringing life and vitality where there is none. That's the trees and the fountains. But look at Isaiah 55, how this takes that same theme. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And he who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me, hear that your soul may live. And I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. There's that same picture of the satisfying refreshment of the Lord. And it's not stuff so much. It's the Lord himself that he gives, right? I will make, I will put, I will set, that they may see and know me. So that spiritually thirsty people will know the overflow of God's mercy and grace. Those who feel like they ought to be cast off may know the love of God for them, refreshed in Christ, in him, Jesus. We ultimately see God fulfill all these things. Just run back through the sermon with me for a minute, or through the text. In Jesus, we ultimately see God's plan for history unfold. We see his ultimate purposes and his sovereignty over all of history. Listen for that in Acts chapter 2. Just listen as I read it. Acts chapter 2, you'll see Jesus as, you might say, the proof that God reigns over all of history. Acts chapter 2, I'm just going to read verse 23, 24. God over all of history. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosened the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. In Jesus, you see how God is sovereign over all history, definite plan, foreknowledge for the good of his people, their deliverance. In Jesus, we see how we are upheld by the living God. He says that he'll never lose one that the Father gave him. We're justified by his record in our place. God upholds, particularly in the Lord Jesus. Let me just read John 6:39. John 6:39, look at how Jesus upholds God's people. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. Do you need to give way to fear? Or does Jesus uphold you? And will Jesus keep you? And has Jesus justified you? In Jesus, we see the ultimate Goel, the kinsman redeemer, the one who keeps, the one who redeems. John 15. There's all kinds of passages here too. We'll just read these two. 15 verse 13. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. And further, no longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you. There's friend of Abraham, friend of the Lord Jesus, kept, redeemed, ransomed. The Goel, the closest of kin, who loves and keeps. He is our strength. He upholds us by his righteous right hand. And in Jesus, we see the ultimate refreshment. We looked at Isaiah, right? Come to me, all you who are thirsty and heavy laden. Do you remember what Jesus cries out at the great feast? Very similar, isn't it? John chapter 7. On the last day of the feast, the great day, Jesus stood up and cried out, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." What does he mean? Come to me for refreshment. Come to me that your soul may be satisfied. Come to me to taste the mercy of God, the love of God, the grandeur of God, the holiness of God, the justice of God. But come to me and be satisfied. Lay down your works. Lay down your self-righteousness. Rest. Rest in me. I will refresh you and keep you. All this that you might see the grandeur of God. And as you see the grandeur of God, your fears begin to shrink. It might not be gone. But as you practice this week, as you look to the future, your false prophecies, let your eyes bounce up to the living God. And remember Isaiah. Remember the one who says, "I am your God. I will keep you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I will strengthen you. I will refresh you." And see what happens to your fear. God does all these things, promises all these things, fulfills them in the Lord Jesus, so that you might see and know, that you might consider and understand together that the hand of the Lord has done this, that the Holy One of Israel has created this, his people, and kept them, that you'd know that you live under his shadow, that you'd know that you live under his care, that you're secure, that you're upheld, that in him is refreshment. Run there so you might live in that reality, with deep trust, with courageous boldness, with glad obedience and joyful sharing, all to his glory, that you might see the hand of God and worship him with joy. Let's pray. Father, you've charged us to fear not, but to trust you. Would you open our minds to see you more so that we'd trust you more and not give way to our false prophecies? Father, as we fear our health and how it's going to go, maybe how it's going, as we fear our financial future with inflation, with markets down, as we fear how our kids are turning out or are going to turn out, as we fear how our relationships are going to maintain, would you press all those things back into their context and cause us to trust you to guide us and to protect us? You said you would uphold us. You said that you rule over Cyrus, over all history from the beginning to the end. You're the first and the last. Then would you rule over these fears? Rule over our lives and help us walk, despite the sorrows, with the confidence in your care. You've promised to uphold us with your righteous right hand. Thank you for the ways you have been doing that. We see that so much in the Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, thank you that we have your record. That because of all you've done, we are your adopted children. We're safe. We're just safe. You've also used means, and we thank you for our military. We thank you for our police officers. We thank you for others who extend that care in keeping us safe. Father, there's so many countries who have none of this, or it's so corrupt. We ask you that you have mercy on them. We pray that as you uphold this whole world, you would look particularly to those countries that are persecuted or at war. We pray that you put an end to the enemy of corruption, the enemy of warfare. Would you defeat Satan? Would you come quickly so that we no longer see your glory diminished? Would you defeat sin in us? Would you help us to take a firm stand against the world's influences, especially through all the media they throw at us? Help us be discerning and wise. Keep us from stumbling. And Lord, as we look to our own weaknesses, we think particularly to those, I just think of Joan who had the brain surgery this week, and many others who are sick or weary. Would you uphold them? Would you so rule that they would be healed and strengthened? Would you lift up those who wrestle with depression? Have mercy, O God, our upholder. You are the one who strengthens us. You, in all your power, would you cause the little acts of your word to spread like wildfire through the world? Do that in Luke, O Lord. Would you even now cause his language learning to turn into witnessing and cause his word shared, perhaps in stumbling language, to hit the mark and to transform a dying man into a resurrected man, a dying woman into a resurrected woman. Work in Nepal through your word, through Benny and his sharing the resources. Work through Christianity Explored. Work through our own individual outreaches, Father, that the weak would become strong as they look to their Savior and gain eternal life. As they gain the gift of the Spirit and we see lives transformed. Oh, what a beautiful thing. We pray for your weak church, so often cast aside or just crippled by sin. Would you cause her leaders to be strong in the gospel, strong in righteousness? Would you cause churches that no longer preach the gospel to repent and open your word and declare your glory? Remember those who have been hurt by the church, those who are disenfranchised, those who are no longer going to church. Would you please, Father, carry your refreshing word to them, restore them, strengthen them? We ask you for your refreshment. Would you refresh each of us here in the good news of our Savior Jesus? Would you refresh us by the greatness of who you are? Cause us not to be dismayed, because you'll give us aid. You promise to strengthen and help us. Then cause us to stand, upheld by your powerful hand. And when we go through trials, cause your all-sufficient grace to be a steady supply to us, that we wouldn't be parched, but that we'd be like Daniel's friends, standing firm, trusting you despite the flame. Father, sanctify us and cause us as we go here this morning to go our way rejoicing because we've met the Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you join me in standing and let's sing together How Firm a Foundation. If you don't know this one, please just concentrate on the words and let them minister to you. And then others, just sing this truth to one another as we praise the Lord for our firm foundation in the Lord Jesus.
How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he hath said, to you for refuge to Jesus have fled. Supply. The flame shall not hurt you. I only design your dross to consume and your gold to refine. Even down to old age, all my people shall be my sovereign, eternal, unchangeable love. And when hoary hair shall their temple adorn, like lambs they shall still in my bosom. At length for repose, I will not desert to his foes. That soul, though all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
Read a little from 1 Peter as we receive his benediction. Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the dominion forever and ever. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Amen.